Alright, well, I know it's been a while. Before, I was basically releasing a video basically every day or two, or at least I was trying to do that, and I haven't really released a video in a few weeks, so I figured it was high time for me to get back and get back into the swing of things. Because, I don't know, I like doing this, I like sharing my thoughts. In spite of the relatively low number of people who actually watch my channel, I still like putting my thoughts down in some format. I mean, partially for posterity's sake, and partially there may come a time when someone disagrees with me or someone offers up, or more people offer up comments on my videos, and I would like to find an outlet for discussion of various forms of media. So now that I got that out of the way, I figured it was high time to talk about the DLC that just came out for The Last of Us. Which is titled Left Behind. Left Behind expands the story of The Last of Us basically at two points in time. The first point in time, I don't really think this is much of a spoiler. The first point in time is basically when Joel gets injured and Ellie is essentially forced to take care of him and just kind of she's forced to pick up the slack when he is incapacitated. So it takes place during that time, and it also periodically flashes back to Ellie's time with her friend Riley, who received a passing mention or two in the actual game and was subsequently expanded upon in a tie-in comic called American Dreams. Now, I never actually got around to reading American Dreams, but I've always thought that the Riley angle, along with a lot of other behind the scenes stories in Last of Us, were worth exploring. And I guess I really shouldn't be surprised that they chose Ellie's relationship with Riley, because obviously that sparked a comic, and that has been speculated on by various fans, so I can't really say I'm surprised. It's definitely not out of nowhere, it's definitely not uncalled for, but I was talking with my cousin, and he actually thinks that, he doesn't really think this is a bad idea, but he actually thinks that it would be more interesting to some people to maybe come up with a DLC for one of the stories that you piece together by finding artifacts in the game. You know, like that one when you're going through the water system, the pipe system, and with Henry, and you find all those notes by that one guy, I forget his name. But that's right for expanding upon, and they even include in the DLC, they even include another story like that, revolving around a stranded group of soldiers. So any one of the stories that you come across, or almost any one of them, could make for a very compelling DLC package. But I think in a way it was in a lot of ways actually it was a lot easier for them to proceed from somewhere where they already essentially had a foothold. Because if you really think about it, if they tried to do a DLC with one of the artifact stories, the stories pieced together by all those notes and whatnot, they would essentially have to come up with all new characters. They would have to elaborate on the story described in notes in more detail. They would have to go through casting, They would have to get inexperienced actors acquainted with the whole motion capture performance. So in a way, it was a lot easier. It was conceivably a lot easier for them to proceed with a story that involved Ellie, because the character of Riley, at least in the American Dreams, was already established. Obviously, they already had the character of Ellie established. They already had the character model for her rendered, so really, they had to do a relatively small amount of work in comparison to what they would have had to do if they had proceeded with an entirely new set of characters. With that said, The Last of Us Left Behind is fantastic. It is definitely it's kind of sticking with the appeal of The Last of Us in that it's very emotionally gripping. And while the gameplay is there, and while you do have a lot of fun with the gameplay, what really sucks you in are these characters, is the acting, and the richly detailed environments. The Last of Us was honestly one of the best games of 2013, if not the best in a lot of people's book. I mean, if I had to rate it in my favorite games of 2013 list, it would be in the top three for sure. I don't know if I would put it at number one, because, and my opinion could be colored by nostalgia on this, but my favorite game of 2013 was Sly Cooper: Thieves in Time. But I grew up with Sly Cooper, so I fully admit that my judgment may have been colored by the fact that I just love Sly Cooper. And that's not to say Thieves in Time was a poorly designed game or a poorly made game. Not in the slightest. I thought it was a fantastic game, but I did notice that a lot of other people thought Last of Us was a lot better. And I'm not out to discredit anyone's opinion on that. Like I try to tell people, entertainment, a large part of the entertainment industry is subjective. So when you're coming up with best of the year lists, whether it be for movies, games, books, etc., there are always going to be people who disagree with your choices, and there are always going to be debates like, did this really deserve to get on there? Did it really? I mean, what merits does this piece of work have? But really, all you can do is you can try to go for how does this game fare in the mass appeal. Or you can just do what are your favorite games. So honestly, if I'm going just on its own merits, not because of any emotional attachment to The Last of Us, not because of any like, oh, I really don't want this to be bad or anything, without any coloring of my opinion, this is honestly honestly, I can't really think of any major problems with this apart from one. It's too short. And I really hate throwing that up, because I really hate throwing out the point that this is not long enough. Because games are generally expected to be very, very long. And usually when you buy a game, you expect its length to justify its asking price. And when you say that something is too short, it honestly feels in my opinion anyway, it feels like more of a blow, because you've just wasted more money than you would have if you had bought a movie. Because movies, for the most part, are generally of similar lengths to each other. I mean, they're differently priced, but they have similar lengths. I mean, unless you have like a 3-hour movie like Lord of the Rings, or maybe like an 80-minute animated movie. But generally, generally movies are all the same. So the asking price, you can't really argue the amount of cinematic content you get for the asking price. But with games, if you buy a game that's like 3 hours long or even 6 hours long, you really feel like I just wasted 60, sometimes even 70, 80 bucks for a game and all this additional extra stuff like unlockable costumes, blah, 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 collector's edition. It's really easy to feel like you wasted your money. And I've felt like that before. I feel like I've wasted my money. So when I say that Last of Us Left Behind is too short, that's not to say that this is a poorly made game. That's not to say that I am disappointed by it. That's not to say that I am not glad that I spent my money on it. Because really, it is just as emotionally impactful, and it is such a fulfilling part of the story that honestly, when it's over, you really do want to play it again. And also when it's over, you do really get the sense that you really want to go back and play The Last of Us or some parts of The Last of Us again, or maybe re-engage in the multiplayer. Or at least that was the case with me. So I don't want to drone on too long. Basically what it amounts to is that the voice acting and the writing is still top notch. And what I found interesting is Ellie's interactions with someone her own age are noticeably different than her interactions with someone like Joel or Bill or David. Because honestly, Riley does like to get Ellie into trouble as they show us. And you really do see that these two have had an ongoing friendship. You really do see that they share this very genuine, this very heartfelt connection, and it doesn't feel artificial. And just like with Ashley Johnson and Troy Baker, the chemistry between Ellie and Riley is just, it's beautiful. It is, I mean, this is just teeming with chemistry. And I think really that was the biggest thing, because if Ellie did not have any chemistry with Riley, then this was dead from the get-go. So the fact that they got that right really paves the way for a large part of the game, story-wise and character-wise. So basically, some people might be off-put by the fact that you don't really spend as much time fighting this time around. But I actually kind of like that. It relies more on atmosphere and storytelling than actual gameplay. And I can understand. I completely understand if a gamer feels like, why don't I get to actually play the game? You get to play the game. You can spend as much time exploring or as little time exploring as you want. But a large part of it, you are essentially, as the player, interacting with Riley and interacting with different things in this mall. One standout moment in my eyes was this sequence where they come across this video arcade, and you essentially, Riley gets Ellie to imagine she's playing the game, and it essentially turns into this Mortal Kombat homage where even at the end, Riley is like, you got an ultimate finish, or whatever. You got an ultimate kill. So, yeah, that was very funny. There is a lot of charm to this game. There is a lot of charm to Riley and Ellie's interactions in the mall. They feel genuine. They don't feel spoon-fed. Like, they come across this Halloween shop, and of course, they ask all these really, really stupid questions to this. It's basically a skull version of a Magic 8 Ball. Like, you shake the skull, and in the bottom of the skull, you see the answer to your question. So, So yeah, that's very charming. And the combat itself, because there is a fair amount of combat, but what I found interesting and what helps differentiate this game from the main campaign of The Last of Us is that Ellie, by no stretch of the imagination, is able to handle herself nearly as well as Joel when it comes to physical combat. I mean, Joel, I'm not saying you couldn't die as Joel, but even though Joel was a tough guy and can easily take out someone else in hand-to-hand combat, or could easily choke out a guy, if he gets ganged up on, or if you try to engage someone in an open gunfight, you have to plan out your moves. But with Joel, at least with Joel, you could fall back on hand-to-hand combat a lot more so than you can with Ellie, because Joel, being as strong as he is, he can conceivably take out someone a lot faster with brute force than Ellie can. I mean, Ellie, really, her melee combat just amounts to her switchblade. Because this could be my shoddy memory, but I don't believe you ever get a melee weapon as Ellie, or at least not the kind of melee weapons that Joel picks up, like the axe or the wooden stick that you can attach scissors to. You don't get any of that. I mean, Ellie, she doesn't have as much health as Joel, and it takes a lot longer for her to take out someone who, let's be fair, is twice her size. And even then, even as you are killing someone with the square button using your switchblade, this guy takes away like half your health. So as Ellie, you are really forced to play it a lot safer and a lot more covert than you are as Joel. She has limited physical strength, but she has more resources. It's the same amount of low resources as in the main game. And you very much are still encouraged to approach gunfights and scuffles with the infected. You really are still encouraged to approach those with some brain power. You are essentially still encouraged to plan out your attack and not draw too much attention to yourself. And as a result, this game offers a few opportunities to actually pit the raiders, the thugs, against the infected, which you will essentially find yourself doing more often than not, because really, as weak as Ellie is physically, it really does come down to, do I really want to risk my life tackling like three infected and three regular guys with guns? I don't think so. So I'm just going to throw a brick and wake up the infected, and they will come after the living guys, and I'll just sit back here and hide. And it's not like you feel the game is too hard. It's just the game gives you that option, and you are very much inclined to take it, because, like I said, you are not really equipped to deal with six guys single-handedly. I mean, you are. I suppose it can be done, but it just comes down to, do you really want to take that risk? Do you really want to risk dying again, just to prove, like, hey, I killed all these guys? No, it's much smarter just to let them kill each other, and you take out the survivors, and then pick up any supplies that they drop. So the combat is still very exhilarating. I mean, it still keeps you very much on your toes. And yeah, the graphics are still gorgeous. This was clearly not rushed out before it was ready. There is still that very admirable attention to detail. The facial animations and the specks of dirt and the freckles and details for Ellie and Riley are still are still very much there, and the environments still look very overgrown. They look run down, but there is still the environments, like in the main game and like in a lot of other games of this type, they actually have a personality of their own, just in how much detail was put into designing them. Granted, I would have liked a chance to interact with the environments with a little more freedom than the game gives me. Like I'm not saying I would do this, but in theory, wouldn't I be able to pick up one of the Halloween masks and throw it at one of the enemies to distract them, just like a brick or a bottle? I mean, granted, it wouldn't hurt as much as throwing a brick or a bottle at them, but I don't know, some people might be like, shouldn't I have that option? But overall, I was very impressed with The Last of Us Left Behind. And really, it impressed me in enough areas to where when it finally ended, I was like, aw, give me more. And again, it's not like I feel ripped off, because again, everything else is just so good that even if you don't feel like playing through it again, you will feel emotionally satisfied. You will feel like I have just experienced a new part of the story. And it was an interesting part of the story, and it was well handled, and I didn't really feel disappointed by it. I got to spend more time with this character that I like. I got to spend more time with this world. It's just that the fact that it's 2 or 3 hours, probably closer to three, maybe 3.5 on normal difficulty. And like I said, there's a strong chance that you might want to go through it again, maybe on hard or survivor difficulty. In fact, I might attempt that myself in a few minutes, but that three hour playtime, it feels like it's over before it really starts. And that may be because Last of Us gave you so much story. It was just such an expansive tale. I mean they literally trekked across a good portion of the United States. And they experienced so much that maybe this just seems minuscule by comparison. I don't know, but 3 hours for the average price of a DLC pack, I don't think you will feel ripped off. I don't think so. I mean, did I have as much fun with this as say Far Cry 3 Blood Dragon? Well, no, because Far Cry 3 Blood Dragon A gave me more bang for my buck, a lot more bang for my buck, in fact. And B, it was a lot more tongue-in-cheek. Last of Us is not meant to be. I hate using this phrase. This game is not meant to be fun. I mean, obviously, you will want to keep playing it, and you will not want to put the controller down, and you will feel satisfied when you're playing it. But this is that was honestly one of the reasons that I put Sly Cooper higher on my mental list of games in 2013 than Last of Us, is because Last of Us, as great as it is so depressing. And this DLC is depressing. But it's not like they are exploiting that depression. It's not like they are exploiting the setting. It's not like they are exploiting any kind of melodrama. It's not James Cameron's Titanic. I mean, you feel like whatever depression that you go through playing this game is well-founded. I mean, yeah. One problem with the game, it's too short. But all the rest of the things, the voice acting, the gameplay, the graphics, the writing, everything else is just so great that I can easily see people overlooking the fact that it's short. So yeah, that's my two cents on The Last of Us Left Behind, and I don't know why you're even sitting here watching my review. Just go play the main game, or go play this DLC. And yeah, that's about it. And I will talk to you later.